We are live.
Thank you, Leonardo. Welcome, everyone, to today's seminar. It's a pleasure to introduce Rita de Cássia dos Anjos, who is a faculty at Universidade Federal do Paraná since 2014 in the palliative sector. Rita graduated in biological physics from the Universidade Estadual Paulista Júlio de Mesquita Filho in 2007 and obtained her master's and PhD in 2014 in the Physics Institute of the University of São Paulo, São Carlos. Rita works with cosmic rays of energies above 1 eV, the Pierre Auger Observatory, and energies between 10 GeV and 100 TeV, with the Cherenkov Telescope Array, CTA. She has experience in the field of astrophysics with emphasis on the propagation of cosmic rays and interactions of particles and gamma rays. She has been a member of the Pierre Auger Cosmic Ray Observatory since 2014 and a member of CTA since 2015. Rita is the 2020 recipient of the L'Oréal UNESCO ABC Prize for Women in Science. And since 2021, she is an affiliate member of the Brazilian Academy of Sciences. Thank you very much, Rita, for accepting our invitation. You may start when you're ready.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Anna. Thanks for having me. And thank you for the kind presentation. So the title of my presentation today is the distribution of arrival direction of ultra-high energy cosmic rays composition. So the overview of my presentation, I will talk a bit about of these particles. I will discuss the main aspects of these particles that are spectrum composition and anisotropy. I will show the recent results from the biggest observatory of these particles, that is Pierre Auger. I will show also the particle propagation and the effect of the galactic magnetic fields on the trajectory of these particles, and I will summarize. So the birth or landmark of cosmic rays physics was in 1912 by the physicist Victor Hess. In these years, Hess made a balloon flight and he reached a height of 5 kilometers. In this plot, in these pictures, you can see Hess inside the balloon and using electroscope for measuring the our ionization of the air, has found that increasing ionization, increasing altitude too. And the discovery was very important because researchers thought that ionization could come from our crust Earth. But no, has found that the ionization you have in our air comes from outside our atmosphere. In this plot, you can see the data from Hess. In the y-axis, you have the ion pairs per volume time. This is ionization. And here you have the altitude. And you can see that increasing altitude, the ionization increased too. And the next years, 1913 and 14, co-hoster had the same result, increasing altitude, increasing the ionization, the measurement of ionization. And Hess conclude, therefore, that the ionization is very high penetrating, and it comes from above, I mean, comes from outside our atmosphere. And for that discovery has won a Nobel Prize in 1936 by the discovery of cosmic radiation. So what are cosmic rays or cosmic radiation? Cosmic rays are subatomic particles. Here, I'm talking about the nuclei as a helium, iron, and nitrogen, and so on. These particles have speeds close to the light speed. They fill all cosmic space and reach the Earth. And what we understand, there are mechanisms of production of these particles at source, accelerated of these particles at source. And how do these particles propagate in our intergalactic medium before arriving here? So the motivation in this area comes from what the observatories measure. There are energy spectra, chemistry composition, and the arrival direction in the sky of these particles. And the questions you want to answer are, what are cosmic ray source, what kind of source, galactic source, extragalactic source, how do cosmic rays propagate inside our galaxies and outside, and of course, how are cosmic rays accelerated at the source? What are the mechanisms of acceleration? So this is a spectrum of this particle, the flux of cosmic rays, okay? And the YX, you have the flux measured by area, spherical area, the direction in the sky of these particles, when these particles arrive, time and energy versus energy, okay? This flux follows a power law spectrum, and then it's possible to describe this plot using a power law, energy to the minus index, spectral index. And you have the shape or the form of this flux is due to several aspects, such as different composition. In this spectrum, you have all possible composition of these particles, from lighter as a proton to the heavy as an ion. You have different sources. You can see here two different colors. And you have source inside our galaxy, for example, explosion of a supernova remnant. And you have, of course, extragalactic source, okay? You have this shape, this form of this spectrum also due to the interaction with cosmic radiations in the space. I mean, these particles propagate in the intergalactic medium and interact with several cosmic radiation. And in this interaction, this particle lost mass, this particle lost energy. And in the end, when these particles arrive here at Earth, you have this form, you have this shape. The another aspect very important of this plot is how you detect these particles. You can see that in more lower energy in the spectrum, the flux is very high. You have one particle per meter square per second. It means that in each second per meter square, you can detect one particle, okay? And the detection here is direct because you have a high flux of these particles. However, when you go to the end of the spectrum, high energy, ultra high energy, you have a too low flux of these particles. You have one particle per kilometer square per year. I mean, each year per kilometer square, you can detect one particle. And then here you use the detection here is made through the extensive air shower or cascade, okay? And here, the primary particle that ultra high energy cosmic rays arrive at the top of atmosphere, interacts with our molecules you have in our atmosphere, nitrogen, oxygen, and so on, and decay in other particles, okay, secondary particles. And then you detect the secondary particles, and we use the secondary particles, their mass, their energy, to get information of primary particles, okay? And then the detection here is not direct. It depends on the secondary particles. So this is another spectrum of these particles, okay? The difference here is that the YX, we multiply the YX per energy to the constant here, 2.7, to see better the breaks in the spectrum, because when you see this spectrum, you can see only a slot, okay? And to see better what happened behind the physics behind this spectrum, you multiply it by a constant here. And in which region, in which breaks you have here a difference in the spectrum. And when you observe this form, it's very useful, and it's very useful correlated form with a shape of a leg, because remembers a leg, okay? And this correlation is very useful because here you have three very important regions. The knee, it's about this energy. Here you have the second knee, something like that. And here you have the ankle. And this correlation is very, really useful because when you talk about the need, for example, with another astrophysicist that worked with cosmic rays, the other person knows what we're talking about the energy, about the composition, about the possible source. And then this correlation is really, really useful. So this is a most new spectrum of ultra-high-energy cosmic rays from Auger Observatory, Pierre Auger. You can see here four different regions. In the same I'm showing here now the spectrum of ultra high energy cosmic rays, okay, starting 10 to the 18 eV. And you can see four different spectrum index, and we're able to identify these regions using the new data, using the statistical of you having each year. In special, this third region in this spectrum, it's really new. It's really new for us. Because before, when you compare this plot with older spectrum in 2017, you can see here only three different regions, gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3. And when you see this region, the semi and the semi energy here and in here, you can observe that its region it's really different that this one. And it happens because when increasing the number of events you collect at year, you have more data and you can see better the form, the shape of this spectrum. And it's very important for us. And the only you have an idea about the number of events, here you can see the number of events in each beam of energy, in lower energy. Of course, when I say lower energy, I'm saying lower energy inside the spectrum of ultra-high-energy cosmic rays, okay? The lower energy, you have a lot of events, and when you go to the end of the spectrum, that what is very interesting, and it's a good questions around this region, of course, and you have a few data. And for that, you need more time, you need more several years for collecting more and more events. So in this plot, this is another spectrum. You can see the data from two different observatories, the Pierre Auger and Malargo here. The observatory Pierre Auger, it's the biggest observatory of cosmic rays. Its area is about 3,000 kilometers square. Its area is two times the city of São Paulo. It's a really huge area. And you can see also the spectrum from, it's a south, of course, Argentina, our neighborhood here. And the another telescopes is a telescope array, which is in Utah, United States, with 700 kilometers square, more smaller, but in north. And when you analyze the data of ultra high energy cosmic rays, you use the data from both observatories because you have the all using the data from both, you have the data of all sky. For that, it's very important to north and south. So this is a spectrum. It's an older spectrum, but it's very interesting that in this spectrum, you have five experiments here. Okay, today it's working only Auger and the telescope array, and the energy of each experiment was multiplied by a constant. Did you see that? Any one experiment you get here has the shape, has the same form, has the same shape. It means that the physics behind of the spectrum of these particles is describing this form, describing the shape. And for that, for us, the shape or form of this spectrum is very, very important. It's essential. And for example, you have more area, you have more investment in size, and it's very important because you need it for describing the physics behind the spectrum. When I say the physics behind the spectra, you can say the possible source the theory models about the sources, about the propagation, about the deflection of these particles due to the galactic magnetic fields and so on. And to see what happened with these particles, it's very important for describing what happened before. Okay. So the flux of these particles, ultra-high energy cosmic rays, is now isotropic. In this plot, you can see the flux of these particles in the Cartesian coordinates. Okay, this is flux starting with energy 80 eV, okay, in Cartesian coordinates. You can see two different regions, the blue and the red region. And the difference of these regions is about 7%, and the red, it's more intense to flux. Okay, and this line is our galactic projection. And then this galactic projection in Cartesian projection here. And this white part, because the observatory Pierre Auger doesn't see this part because he's in south, okay? So the interpretation of this plot is the following. Here you have, in this star, you have the center of our galaxy. And the another side, you have the intensity flux of the ultra-high energy cosmic rays. It means that the flux of these particles, ultra-high energy cosmic rays, comes from outside our galaxy. Otherwise, you see the intense flux, the intensity flux around the center of our galaxy, because it's the region with more intensity events, and you have several environments and so on. And this result, it's very essential, because now, today, you know that the ultra-high energy cosmic rays comes from outside our galaxy. So this is the extensive shower or cascade, and you have the primary particle, father particle, mother particle that collides at the top of atmosphere, interacting with our molecules you have in our atmosphere, and generating charged and neutral pions. And you know that the pions, neutron pions, decay in gamma, and then decay in electromagnetic part. And this part of this cascade, you call electromagnetic part of this cascade, because in the end you have a lot of pair electron positrons. And you have the hadronic part of this cascade, is the nuclei. Okay, a principal nuclei, and the charged pions decay in muons. You have a lot of muons too. And here you have muonic part of this cascade. Okay, and when you observe the longitudinal structure of this cascade and the development of this cascade, you have this, something like that. And here you have, at the top, you have one particle. Here is the number of these particles, and here is the depth, considering, of course, our atmosphere. And the unity of the depth is mass per centimeter square per area, because you have the several particles, and you have the mass of these particles penetrating in our area, okay? And here you have one particle, and as you have the development of this shower, you have the increasing of the number of these particles to the maximum, and after, the number of these particles decreases here. And the X max of this cascade is related to a chemical composition of the particle that collides here, the top of the atmosphere, because the unit of the X max or maximum of this cascade is related to the max, to the mass of these particles. And then getting the one particle that collides, these particles, you have, this particle has X max, and we analyze the X max to see, to get information of the chemical composition that collides here. Okay. So this is a simulation. It's a cascade starting of, started using a proton, nucleus of proton with energy about 10 to the 19 eV, You can see the purple red, it's electromagnetic part of this cascade. It's about 90%. It's a lot of. You have here the white part of the cascade, is the medium of this cascade, is the hadronic part. And you can see the several colors around that are muonic part of this cascade. So this is a structure of our observatory in Largo, the Pierre Auger. The colors are our telescope for four different regions, okay? And the white dots are the tanks, okay, the tanks. And for that, the detection of the observatory is hybrid because you use the information from the tanks and information from the telescopes to get, in the end, information of primary particles. And here you have the development of the shower, and then the shower is seen. The development of this shower is seen through the telescopes. The telescopes, he sees the shower. And when the shower reaches the ground, it triggers several tanks. And again, you use the information of these tanks and the information from the telescopes to get information of the primary event here. When I say get information of this particle here, I'm talking about of its energy, okay, composition, x max of this particle, and of course the direction of this particle in the sky. So this is a real event that happened at Auger, and this event was seen in Los Leones and Los Morados, and it triggered several tanks, you can see here. And you get the information from tanks and Los Leones, Los Morales to get information of this event. This process to get information we call reconstruction, because you need the reconstruction, all the shower to get this information. It's very interesting. So this is a composition plot. Here you have the X max versus energy. And the dashed lines was made using the cross section in the laboratories. But here we needed the extrapolation of this cross section because you know that this you can't still, of course, this energy in our laboratories, for example, considering HC. And then I think this its energy is about 10 to the 17 today. And then you get the cross section there and extrapolate the high energy, okay? And the dots are the dots are the Auger data. And the interpretation here is very interesting. You can see four different lines, dashed lines, with four different composition. And in our energy in this region, you can see that the datum is closer to the hydrogen and the helium composition. And for that, the composition of ultra-high energy cosmic rays in this region, in this energy, around the energy, is light. When you go to the more high energy here, the composition of the data from Auger is heavy because in this region, the data is closer to the nitrogen and iron curves. Okay, this is a really and essential interpretation. I mean that when you get the spectrum of these particles, you know that in the end of this spectrum, the composition of these particles is heavy. So the study of anisotropy correlates the arrival direction of these particles you measure with the direction of possible sources in the sky. Okay, in this study of correlation, you must consider only ultra high energy cosmic rays starting 55 or more. EEV, this is 10 to this 18 electron volt, okay? Because these particles suffer the deflection of the intergalactic magnetic field and the galactic, and increasing the energy of these particles, you have a field deflection, and then you consider only ultra high, and for that you have a really few data for this study, but it's very interesting, and our results. And of course, this is one part of puzzle, okay, about the anisotropy, but you need some this part with more propagation and mechanism selection the source, and in the end you have the problem, okay. And in this plot you can see the black dot are our event from UG. It's our result, okay. And but it's very interesting because our conclusion is it's working for the same same sources, I think. And the circle, it's a possible AGN. And then you correlate what you measure about the direction of the possible sources and the sky. This plot is the same idea, but it's a new plot. And you can see that intensity colors, you can see a more intensity, more correlation between the direction of our events with possible sources. So summarizing the recent results from Pierre Auger, what we have today, you have a spectrum well-defined, and which year you have more and more defined the spectrum. It's very interesting for us because we improve our theory models analyzing the spectrum. You have a heavy composition in the end of the spectrum, and you have a possible correlated with a nearby source, some AGNs, starbursts and the radio galaxies. So the most efficient mechanism of acceleration of this particle is diffusive shock acceleration. And this mechanism involves a shock waves, okay, shock waves moving through the plasma. And in this mechanism, the particles ping pong back and forth across the shock wave, gain energy in each cycle. And when the particle leaves this region, the particle is accelerated. Okay, and in this region, the shock wave creates a turbulence in the magnetic field, and the particle are reflected several times in this region and gain energy inside this region. And when this particle leaves, the particle is accelerated. Of course, that this process is upstream, downstream, upstream. I mean, the particles lost, of course, energy, but in the end, there is an increase of the energy because you have the region with the intense magnetic field. Okay, and this mechanism happens inside radio galaxies, inside the relativistic jet, you can see here, inside the starbursts and other environments in this space. And what it's very important in this mechanism and the order, of course, about the acceleration of these particles, that is, when you get these particles and distribute it their energy in the histogram, for example, you have a power law spectrum. Because what we measure here at Earth is a power law spectrum. And then you must consider a power law spectrum from the source of this particle. And when you use these mechanisms in our models, you have a power law spectrum. For that, this is very very important mechanisms, and we use this mechanism in our models. So there's another mechanism, it's very interesting. It's an espresso mechanism, and here you have a seat. The idea, the basic idea here is that you have a particle accelerated up to the 10 to the 17 eV. And then in this case, the particle is accelerated out. And this particle from, for example, a supernova explosion of a supernova remnant. And this particle penetrates into a relativistic jet. And independently of its trajectory inside the jet, you can see here three different trajectories. This particle receives a one or short boost in your factor Lorentz square, in square, in energy. And when this particle leaves this region, this particle is accelerated. And for example, here you have the possible trajectory of this particle inside the jet. And the final energy is increased by the Lorentz factor square, okay? This mechanism is very interesting because when you bring it together, the spectrum from these particles, from supernova remnant, for example, you have the dashed line, the dashed lines, and after the boost in your particles, you have the solid lines. When you sum the two kinds of this spectrum, you can describe the spectrum of particles starting in the knee, starting in 10 to the 15 or PeV electron volt. Of course, this is one kind of mechanism. You have another mechanism for describing all spectrum. But this mechanism is very interesting because you have, in the end, a power law spectrum, and you can observe here several compositions, and it's a very, very interesting mechanism. It's a really new mechanism, and of course you have this environment in this space because you have a relativistic jet, and inside you have a high magnetic field, and the shock these particles suffer inside the relativistic jet is like something like that, is a diffusive shock acceleration. And then you have the parallel spectrum. So when you consider the propagation of these particles in intergalactic medium, the process, the photodisintegration process, it's very important, and especially in high energy and heavy composition. In this mechanisms, you have the nuclei collides with the photons. You have the intergalactic medium cosmic radiation, and the nuclei lost energy, of course, after interaction, but lost mass too. Okay, and you can see here the Manfred path, how much the particle walks before the next interaction. Okay, the definition of Manfred path. Versus energy for the process of disintegration, photodisintegration, considering several nuclei. And then you can observe that this Manfred path decreases very fast, increasing the energy, and increases with increasing composition. And the conclusion here is that in the end of this Manfred path, in high energy, survives only heavy nuclei, because lighter nuclei lost mass in their path before these particles arrive here in this energy. Okay, and when you simulate a possible all possible composition and isotropic direction in the sky for describing all spectrum of cosmic rays, you have this plot. And you can observe that in the end of this spectrum, you have only heavy composition. Heavy composition, and it shows that the process of photodisintegration is very important. And these results agree what the observatory measure. In the end of the spectrum, you have a heavy composition. So you see in this plot, you see the effect of the galactic magnetic fields on the trajectory of these particles inside our galaxy, okay? And the idea here is the fall. The particles penetrate in our galaxy from the direction of a source. And the question is, where you stop inside the galaxy? And then after, we calculated the fraction of these particles, consider the direction of nearby source. Here, for example, starbursts and the radio galaxies. Of course, the model I used here was Jensen Farrar. It's a really new model of magnetic field. And this model is agrees very well with the data, what we imagine about the magnetic field inside the galaxy. And of course, you know that the deflection increasing with increasing the composition, okay? And the decreases with increasing the energy. And here you have the parameters that you consider at the source, the energy and the index spectrum, okay? And you can observe when you compare the two plots that here you have more fraction. You have more fraction of these particles considering the direction of starburst. It's very important to say here that I didn't consider any aspect of starbursts or regular galaxies. No, I've considered only the direction of this source, okay, in the sky. And you have, of course, you can see the more fraction from direction of the starbursts. And here I increased the energy, and when I increased the energy, it doesn't make sense to consider the lighter nuclei due to the effect of photodisintegration, and you can observe also that you have more fraction from direction of starbursts nearby starbursts. And here you can see the deflection of these particles from some starbursts and for various nuclei. And here you can observe that when you compare helium with iron, for example, have more deflection from iron. And of course, when you increase the energy, you decrease the deflection from NGC 253. And the same idea have the same behavior from all starbursts. Okay, it's the same idea for all. These results show that it's very important to consider the galactic magnetic field in our simulations. Sometimes, for example, some years ago, when you say, so I'm studying or I'm working only ultra high energy cosmic rays, then I can turn off the galactic magnetic field. But no, it's really wrong. Today, you understand that the effect of extra galactic magnetic field and galactic magnetic field is very important, because this the effect of this magnetic field is too high, and you need to consider in our simulation. So here today I discussed with you several aspects of charged particles. Okay, consider the deflection of these particles inside our galaxy. Okay, but of course you have the deflection outside too. But you have the photon or gamma, and you have the neutrino. These particles, you call all these particles as a multi-messenger particles, but in special, photon and the neutrino are multi-messenger, because you can measure these particles from the source direct. And but these particles also are product of the interaction of these charged particles with the intergalactic with the cosmic radiation. And when you propagate charged particles, you have the spectrum of the photon and the spectrum of the neutrino as a product of these interactions. And today you use the informations from each messenger to get information from the charged particles, and also to get information from the source. And today, when you talk about the propagation of this particle, it's very important to consider all possible particles from this propagation. And summarizing, our simulations must consider this source, the mechanism at the source. And here, it is very important to consider to say, what are your simulation? Okay, it's not only consider the distance, but you need to say, for example, what kind of your source. It's a pulsar, it's a supernova remnant, it's a radio galaxy, and so on. Okay. You needed the environment propagation, the cosmic radiation. Today I didn't show the possible cosmic radiation, but it's a subject for another talk. But you have CMB, you have radio, you have any. And the effect, of course, the magnetic fields. And in the end, your model should describe the data, the spectra from Auger, from telescope array, and so on. Of course, that sometimes you don't, you are considered only the region. For example, I mean, work only the ankle, only the end of the spectrum. And you consider an index spectra there, you consider the possible sources and composition there. And then my models must describe only the ankle. Because when you consider the all spectrum have several parameters and the analysis is not easy, of course. So my conclusion that when you study the propagation, it's very important to consider the galactic and extra galactic, and in the end you sum the results. At sources, you must consider the mechanism of acceleration of these particles with messenger particles, interaction of these particles and the product of these interactions, and of course, the magnetic fields. So in the future, you have the Cherenkov telescope array, the CTA. It's an observatory for measuring the gamma radiation, gamma in GeV, TeV. And observing gamma, you have information from charged particle cosmic rays. Okay, it's exciting if this observatory, I think in 2022, you start. And the Pierre Auger observatory had an upgrade in the two years ago, at the Auger Prime, and in the future you hope you have more information about the chemical composition of each particle, because I showed that today you depends on the X max, okay? But to get the information of the X max, you have the process, the reconstruction. You need the secondary particles, and for that you have a error there, and in the end you don't have the specific mass of each particle, and with upgraded you have to get more information of the mass of these particles. Okay, so thank you for your patience and attention.
Thank you very much for your talk, Rita. For the people following the talk on YouTube, thank you for joining us. If you have any questions, please post them on the channel. See you next week for the last seminar of the semester on stellar phylogenesis. Goodbye. Now we go to the breakout.